So we discussed the how to construct the validity and reliability of the questionnaire. Now we move to another type of data collections for our research in language teaching and learning on applied linguistics. Besides the most popular data collections of is the questionnaire, we still have other kind is the observations. Observation here, we say the classroom observations. Observations are valuable source of data in educational research, particularly understanding the language, learners' behaviors, and the interactions within the classroom settings. So when we observe the classroom, we see the phenomena in the classroom, what's going on, how the teacher conduct the class. The teaching method, is it the true teaching method that described in your research of the research methodology, and how the student and the teachers interact in the classroom, how peer-to-peer interactions, for example. Observations can provide contextual information, allowing for collection of rich and detailed data about language learning, because the observer, the researcher, can see everything in their eyes, right, in front of their eyes, such as the amount of time spent on each task, the teacher for the organize the student to do the task, how long that task spent, and how long do the student interact, and what do they do, for example, how their behaviors, their attitudes, their motivations, the types of activities engaged, and levels of student participant. If the student are motivated to learn, to participate in the activities in the task, observation-based studies usually involve a researcher observing and recording the activities and behaviors of the language learners in a classroom, typically using a predetermined observation protocol or checklist. So when you observe, you also need to create the checklist so that what's going on, yes, check, if no, check no, for example, so that you can recall every footprint, everything in the classroom. These checklists can be developed based on the category, such as language production and interaction patterns for features of classroom activities. The researcher might, for example, observe the amount of time each student speaks, or types of questions they ask, or types of activities that the teacher is using in the class, so you can observe in your own eyes. One advantage of observation-based research is the rich data generated by the process. For example, a study in a language classroom, an observer might record the amount of time the student spends speaking in the target language, in English, for example. This information provides useful insights into activities that are more language intensive and suggests where students may need more support or instruction. So when we observe the classroom, we see how the what the teacher do, how the student responds, and how they interact, right? Observation can also help researchers identify patterns of interaction between the learners, such as gender, language barriers, if they are fluent or they have the barrier of the language, or they are shy, for example, or age-based groupings. If we group the student into different age, or mixed age, that might affect the learning environment and interactions. An example of observation-based study in language learning was conducted by Hunsen and Katun. The study's objective was to examine the effectiveness of collaborative learning strategies on students' language learning outcomes. So for collaborative learning, that's very good to do observational studies to collect the data through the observation, right? The researchers observed and recorded the interaction between students during the collaborative learning section when they cooperate to brainstorm or to discuss or to to give the ideas how to conduct the test, for example, the task, for example. And the researcher observe and take note the activities engaged in and measure the amount of time spent on different language activities. Results show that using collaborative learning activities improve students' language learning outcomes compared to traditional classroom. So traditional classroom, the teacher teaching the classes may be teacher-centered, but for the collaborative learning, student-centered, that the student work together, discuss together, make the goal together, brainstorm together, make an outline together, and do together. So during the collaborative learning, they interact, so they improve their language skills, for example, at least in the speaking skills, the proficiency. And actually, that's also affect their maybe teamwork, right? Teamwork ability, spirit. So I give you one example of the observation checklist. For example, you need class information, classroom information, what class, what level, the class size, how many students are there in the classroom, and lesson type, is it grammar, teaching, conversation, or reading, writing, duration of the lesson, 45 minutes, or three periods, 3 hours, time of the day, morning, afternoon, evening, and teacher observation, and verbal interaction of the teacher, how the teacher interact, command English in the classroom, they use L1 or L2 Vietnamese English at the same time, or just monolingual, or teacher language proficiency, if the teacher has good command of English in the language proficiency, use of the questioning techniques, what kind of questions she use, instructional approach, for example, if the teacher use student-centered or teacher-centered, teacher-led all the activity, and student observation, you can observe the participation level, and on-task behavior, if they do the task motivationally, and student attitude and motivation towards learning, and group interaction during the activity, use of target language of English, for example, if the student use English to discuss in the group when they do the task or they speak Vietnamese only. Classroom activity observation, you can observe type of activity like group discussion, role play, debate, or writing, or grammar, do tasks, for example, and language focus, vocabulary, grammar, pronunciation, and use of technology in the classroom or not. Classroom material use, for example, they use the textbook or social media, multimedia, or handouts, or whatever you observe. And use of student output, for example, group work, pair work, presentation, student presentation. So these are the thing that in general you can see and you can use it to create your own checklist for your classroom observation if you use this kind of data collection. It depends on the purpose of your research, right? So this is a good example of the checklist. So use this checklist to construct classroom observation. Record the data according to the categories mentioned above that I just told you, and help maintain consistency among different observations. Remember, it is important to review the checklist based on specific research question and adjust the categories if necessary. Why you need to adjust? Because this is just one example. We have different category. You observe the teacher, observe the student, observe the classroom, observe the activity, for example. But maybe your research question is different, and then you need to adjust the question to the checklist to see if those things are to help you to answer the your own research question with your own research purpose. It is important to remember that observations are not objective, and the observer's interpretation of behavior or activity observed can depend on ethnic bias and personal experience. Why? Because like you see when you're teaching at your school, and sometimes some teacher observe your classroom, they take note and then they give you some kind of suggestion. Sometimes their suggestion is on their own teaching experiences. So sometimes it's good, but sometimes it might not be good because that's their own personal experience. And different people have different beliefs and perspective on teaching. So observation might be biased. In this situation, checklist make your observations more objective, right? And you also need to take note during the observation. So that would be good. Therefore, it is helpful to establish inter-rater, interpret, and record data similar to help increase reliability of the data. So when you observe the classroom, you should not do it by yourself. You need one more person, at least two or three people, observe the classroom and discuss the activities that the teacher do in the classroom, weaknesses, strength, so that it is not very objective. It is at least based on the beliefs and perspective of two or three different people. So it is a little bit more objective, right? Observation data works best in conjunction with other forms of data collection for triangulation purposes. For example, if your survey research that you use questionnaire and you use interview, and maybe observation might be another kind of data to help respond to your research question to make the result more valid and reliable.